Hey, brothers and sisters. This is your favorite brother from another mother. I've been meaning to do a video of a communion for a long time. Many people have asked me. I think we may have done one a long, long time ago. But anyway, praise God, we'll do one now. And brothers and sisters, you know, really, today is Resurrection Sunday. And, you know, it's really a day that we celebrate the resurrection of the Lord, and where with a communion we celebrate the death, burial, and burial of our Lord. And so we the time to do it, probably that's why I'm laughing, because the one day probably in my thinking of not to do communion would be Resurrection Sunday, because the focus is the resurrected Lord. And that's why when you have, for a lot of people, when you go to a church and like people have a crucifix, you know, he is not here, for he is risen. Let me talk about the communion. The communion service will be in a few minutes. So anyone that, you know, the people that I don't know why people love to run to and fro, but it'll be later on in the video. So I will say this. That is why, really, in the Catholic Church, they have the crucifix. Because in the Mass, Catholic Mass, they are saying they're crucifying the Lord afresh. That when they take the bread and the wine, they use wine, that is literally eating the flesh and the blood of Jesus. And they use John chapter 6 as one of those texts to support that. In John chapter 6, where the Lord talks about, this is my body indeed, this is my blood indeed. He goes on to say the things I'm talking about are spiritual. But anyway, brothers and sisters, this is called transubstantiation, but for us, brothers and sisters, and what one of the biggest points that started the return of the church to the book of Acts, otherwise known as the Reformation, called the protest, what the Romans call it is the protest, or Protestants. What started the Reformation, one of the biggest parts of that was the fact that we are not cannibals. We are not eating the flesh and blood of Jesus. Jesus said, "You do as often as you do this in remembrance of me." So remember what the Lord did for us. So you get yourself some, you know, you can use, a lot of people use regular bread. I try to find something that's unleavened. There used to be a Christian bookstore down, you know, in the city where I lived. And I had some little wafers and all that stuff. And I know you can buy them online. But what I did is I went to the store and I looked, and whenever I get some, when I come to the States, I always look for something with no leaven in it, no yeast. And so I got a Triscuit. And so this is made out of wheat and there's no yeast in it. You know, so a lot of times you look at that flatbread, a lot of it has yeast in it. You can find some, you know, of course you can get the matzah bread, you know, the Jewish matzah bread. But I just wanted to get something that, you know, that, you know, maybe it tastes better or whatever. So in the package of the matzah, it's not really, you know, good. But if you get you some communion wafers, I'm sure you can find them on Amazon nowadays. You know, you could have them and they'll last for years or whatever, and get little kits. A lot of these churches now, they have little kits. It's like a little juice and a little wafer. Costs a little bit more, but if you wanted to do communion on a regular basis, you know, a lot of times people say too, you need to have at least two people. I kind of, you know, you don't have to, but it's nice if you have, you know, someone that you're breaking bread with, you know, because Jesus said, when two or more of you are gathered in my name, there I'm in the midst. So when one person is by yourself, I mean, yes, you worship the Lord, you commune with the Lord, but it's not the church. So the church is when two or more humans who are, you know, come together in the name of the Lord, then the Lord is in the midst of us as the church, the ecclesia, the called out ones. I just wanted to throw this in there, a little nugget for you, brothers and sisters. The other day, I don't watch any TV really, but the news maybe. But I turned it over and they were having a special on CNN about the Thomasinian Christians. And Thomas, which if you look at church history, Doubting Thomas, he went to India. And today there are over 7 million people in India who are descendants of the first church that Thomas started in India before he was martyred. And anyhow, you know, early church fathers wrote about that. It's not in the Bible, but all the apostles went different places and then their disciples wrote about it. We call them the early church fathers. And then they would write to the different, every city had a bishop before Rome took over, before Constantine, all the major cities had their own bishop. And then they would write letters to each other. And they say that you can put together the whole New Testament, save 7 Bible verses. from the letters they wrote to each other. So from the first and second century before, you know, older than some of the original copies we have of the Bible, there is the Bible written in letters to each other, as they would quote from the apostles to each other. So it's another, you know, extra biblical confirmation that the Bible that we have is the original text. As I said, you can put the whole New Testament together, save seven Bible verses from these letters, like the bishop who would be there when, after Thomas was gone, he would write a letter and get it sent to the bishop of Smyrna. And he would say, you know, just like what, you know, the apostles said in this letter, you know, they would get a copy of what Paul wrote and what John wrote and what Peter wrote. They would quote it to each other and talk about the meaning of it. So that's how we know, as an example, that even the early church fathers wrote about the rapture, like Irenaeus in his a book called Against Heresies, book number 4. He wrote about the pre-tribulation rapture, and that was in the second century. Now, this guy, Irenaeus, was the disciple of Polycarp, who was the disciple of the apostle John, who wrote Revelation and John 1 and all that, who was the disciple whom Jesus loved, so called in the Bible. He talked to his student, Polycarp, who taught his student, Irenaeus, who wrote about a pre-tribulation rapture. That's one of the earliest references to it, you know, outside the Bible, a commentary on the Word of God. So anyway, brothers and sisters, nothing new, nothing from William Darby in 1830 and all that. Y'all, a simple Google search of pre-tribulation rapture, historical support for the pre-tribulation rapture, you will find people who wrote about it throughout the centuries, the first century, second century, third century, sixth century, etc. There's tons of church fathers who wrote about a pre-tribulation rapture for over the last 2,000 years. And as we're talking about this, what happened is we went through the Dark Ages, where the church at Rome moved from Christianity in 300 AD all the way into the opposite of Christianity, operating in the spirit of Antichrist by 600 AD. And then they tried to burn, destroy, and stamp out anyone that didn't agree with them all the way up until even Martin Luther. They tried to kill him. But so that's why the restoration of the church, as the Lord has been restoring the church since that period of Reformation, since the 1500s, God has been slowly restoring his church. And each denomination that came along added a little bit more understanding of the Word of God. So even today, even though there's lots of falling away going on, when you get to spirit-filled, non-denominational churches, you do have some that go into heresy, but there are some who are, and that's where God is always delivering the revelation, restoring his church back to like the book of Acts, back to the Last Supper, is in those people that won't be bound by religion, won't be bound by the system of Babylon and by the system of Rome, which is the same thing as Babylon, trying to bind God's people in specific ceremonies and all this, and none of that stuff is in the Bible. Even myself, brothers and sisters, I was just thinking about the other day, the Lord is reminding me about it. You know, when I used to do work with Filipinos in the States, before I moved to the Philippines, I started three different Filipino churches. And then there was another group that broke off, and as the Filipino pastor started coming, I was praying for the Lord because I was going to the Philippines. I was finishing up my school after 4 years. And I said, Lord, you know, you got to send Filipino pastors to take over these groups because I'm going, or let them integrate into American churches because I'm going to the Philippines. And so Filipino pastors started coming, about three or four different ones. You know, one was a Baptist, one was from Assemblies of God, et cetera, et cetera. And so one of them who, I don't even know if he's been in and out of the ministry two or three times. The guy's a special character. And he was even friends with Apollo C. Kibaloy, which is a guy who says he's the Messiah there in the Philippines. He has 3 million followers, even all around the world. It's called the Sunshine Network. You can look it up. He's got satellite and radio and all this. And he claims he's the appointed son of God. But anyway, this guy was used to fellowship with him back before he went totally off the deep end. So this guy's kind of halfway. But I remember that in his group, he invited me. You know, he said, well, I'm going to come speak to your group and you're going to come speak to my group. I said, all right, great. So when I went, he kept asking me because I didn't have a worship. My worship team wasn't coming. And he said, well, you know, what are you going to do about praise and worship? I said, well, you know, God will make a way. We'll work it out. You know, you don't always have to have praise and worship, but I'm going to play praise and worship at the end of the service. So he was all bent out of shape. He went off the deep end because I wouldn't have, you know, three, you know, worships, a praise song and a worship song or whatever. and following a formula and a ceremony before I spoke. I just prayed and then I spoke. And then at the end, I played worship music and invited the people to come, you know, do an altar call. And he was just totally, it was just like, it was blasphemy to do that. And as a matter of fact, when I got there, he even got his singers to get up and sing there before we started, even after I told him I wasn't going to do that. And of course, he didn't speak to me anymore after that, because I got up and that's what I was going to preach on anyway, about the religious spirit and, you know, this formality and rituals that people form and try to make something out of it. So when the Lord gave us the Last Supper, it wasn't that you get saved by doing it. That's what happens with religious people. You get saved by the ceremony of taking communion. As an example, as I'm talking about the Catholic Church, they call it vitamin J. I got to go get my vitamin J. I go into a state of grace when I do this ceremony. That's never God's intent, but that's what man always does and makes religion. It's like water baptism. We get water baptized after we're saved as a first act of obedience and bearing our first fruit as a Christian, is that the Lord commanded us to be water baptized to show, as it says in the Bible, that we're buried with Christ and raised with him. Therefore, I'm going to do it. And many people ask me all the time, do I need to be water baptized to be saved? No, but if you're saved, you want to get water baptized. That's an act of obedience to the Lord. It symbolizes, as I said, as Paul tells us, that we're buried with Christ. When you lay down in the water, as if you're buried with Christ, and you come back up out of the water, we're resurrected with him. We go down in the flesh and come back a new man in Christ, as the Bible says. I behold all things, you know, old things have passed away, all things have become new. That I'm a new man in Christ. It's symbolic of that. You're not literally coming up and you're in a glorified body. See, when you eat this, you're not literally eating the flesh and blood of Jesus. You're not literally being saved by doing this. This is, we do in remembrance of what Jesus did, or what people call Good Friday. As I said, the Lord wasn't even crucified on Friday. He was crucified the day before Passover, which it was either Wednesday or Thursday. So it's up, you know, the Lord was in the ground for 3 days and three nights. If he was put in the ground before dark on Friday night and rose early in the morning on Sunday, that's only 36 hours. That's like a day and a half. The Lord said, it's prophesied, and the Lord said many times in the Gospels, for 3 days and three nights, he will be in the belly of the earth, even as Jonah was in the belly of the fish. 3 days and three nights. So anyway, that's another tradition that doesn't matter, and it's garbage, and people just, you know, do this on Friday, and you do this and all this, people trying to follow these traditions. Follow Jesus. Don't follow traditions. That's what the message from the Lord today. Don't follow traditions. Follow Jesus, because he's not on the cross. You don't need to look at a crucifix. He's not here, for he is risen. He's not on the cross. He's not in the tomb. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, forever making intercession for Christians. The Lord is seated at the right hand of the Father waiting on us. Now, one time he stood up. When did he stand up? It's a trivial question. It's kind of sad today with Google. It's hard to, you know, ask people a question. When was the time that Jesus stood up since he's been in heaven? He stood up when Stephen was about to be stoned. He stood up and looked over the rail at heaven to honor Stephen. Acts chapter 7 or along in there, 7, 6 and 7 is when, and 8 maybe, Stephen is stoned after he gives a long speech to the Sanhedrin. Anyway, brothers and sisters, let's pray. We will take our communion. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we come before you, Lord God. And Lord, everyone's got their bread, their wheat product here. We've got our fruit of the vine. I have a grape juice here. And Father, we just come before you right now in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you for your only begotten Son. Father, we worship you for your only begotten Son. We thank you, Lord God, that you gave us Jesus Christ, your Son. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. Because of what the Lord has done for us, we give thanks. Let's give him thanks. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. Because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks. Hallelujah, Lord. We thank you, Lord God, for the Lord Jesus Christ, who nearly 2,000 years ago had his body given for us. And just as Paul said, the text that people always use when they do this is from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. The actual, one of the earliest, if not the earliest, writings of the gospel message. When Paul's writing were some of the first ones that were written, even before most of the gospels, even though Matthew was probably written before. You know what I'm just thinking? I forgot to tell you guys when I was talking about those Thomas Christians. The reason why I was going to tell you that is because he had a special on it on CNN the other night. Some of you might have seen it. And what they said was is that those guys, the Catholics came in and burnt all their texts because they thought they were a cult. Anybody that doesn't agree with all their wacky false doctrines is a member of a cult, of course, right? As a matter of fact, in the Catechism, it says that born-again evangelical Christians are going to go to hell, but non-believers are going to go to heaven because they don't know any better. But evangelical Christians are going to go to hell. It's right in the Catechism. Anyway, brothers and sisters, when they do the communion in the Thomasinian churches in India, they say the words in first century Aramaic. I just wanted to put that out there. First century Aramaic. Not in Hebrew, not in any other language, but in first century Aramaic. Just as Thomas spoke, just as the disciples spoke, just as the Lord spoke. First century Aramaic, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah, praise God. Your New Testament was originally written in Greek, brothers and sisters, in Greek. In Greek. And the Old Testament was written in Hebrew until you get to Daniel. And half of Daniel was written in Hebrew and half in Aramaic. That is the time that the nation of Israel, Hebrew became a dead language. Only in writing and only in ceremonial practices in the synagogues did they use Hebrew. Just like in the Catholic Church, they used Latin up until 1962, until the Second Vatican, whatever it is, the Second Vatican Council that they had. Then they converted to using the local language. But Hebrew was like Latin at the time of Christ, brothers and sisters, only used in the synagogues. It became what we call a dead language until after the end of the 19th century, the beginning of the 20th century, there was a man whose last name is, I believe it's Israel. I used to know his name. He was the one that God used to bring back Hebrew as a language. And now they speak the ancient Hebrew, which they haven't spoken since the time of the Babylonian captivity, brothers and sisters. But anyway, brothers and sisters, praise God. Praise God. God is restoring all things, the nation of Israel, and he's restoring that remnant. You know, the church from the book of Acts, from the day of Pentecost, from 120 people, you know, out and out and out and out. And then it began to be watered down through Rome and all that. And then it was like, oh, we're all Christians. We're all Christians. You pass under the, you know, Constantine held up his, you know, had his generals hold up their sword or whatever, or Constantine did himself, and all the people passed under the sword. All right, that makes you a Christian. You know, until it's going in reverse. And as Christianity returns back, like in John chapter 6, back to where the people, you know, even turned away because the Lord said, oh, this saying's too hard. We need to just walk away from this guy. And then Jesus said, to just those few remaining, will you also leave me? You know, and Peter gave that confession. You know, where else would we go? Because you are the only one that has the words of life. He said to the Lord in John chapter 6, that was Peter's first confession of faith. You usually don't hear about it. You hear of his second confession of faith when he said, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God, there in Matthew chapter 16. But in John chapter 6, Peter had made an earlier confession that you have the words of life. Where else would we go? Hallelujah, in Christ. So the church is going back to that few number, back in reverse. It's like, you know, even the back of the book that I wrote, we even put a graph in there where it goes from just a few out and out and out and out, and then it's going back down to just a few. And all these people are into all these cults and all these dead denominations that deny the virgin birth, deny the inerrancy of the Word of God, all those things. Brothers and sisters, praise God. If you're watching my videos, you're not a part of that group. Some people are, and then they got back to the Lord. I get a testimony from somebody every day. Nearly every day saying that, you know, I was like that, I was lukewarm, etc. And I praise God that I found the messages that God gave you to give the church that set me back on awake, that I'd be part of the five wise virgins. Praise God Almighty, brothers and sisters. So on the night that the Lord was betrayed there at the Last Supper, Passover, he took the bread and he broke it. And he gave it to them. And he said, here, take this. This is my body that was broken for you. 40 lashes save 39, save one. The tradition of the Roman Empire, they would give 40 lashes and withhold one as a sign of mercy. So people that were beaten by the Roman government were usually given 39 stripes. And the Lord, by his stripes, we are healed. The Bible says, so the Lord's body was broken for us. He himself took upon our sicknesses, our infirmities. He became our sin, the Bible says, on the cross. Hallelujah. He took our sins and bore our diseases. Hallelujah. He became sin for us. Hallelujah. At the cross, where I first saw the light, where the burdens of my heart rolled away. Just like the stone was rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight. Hallelujah. Now I am happy all the day. Hallelujah. Praise God. Here, take and do this in remembrance of me. Let's receive it. If you need to repent, the Bible says don't take the communion unworthily. That's again, 1 Corinthians chapter 11. You're putting a curse on yourself. You're bringing the judgment of God upon yourself if you take communion when you're not repented. That's what Paul says. For all you once saved, always saved people, go read the same text about that. That many have died. Fall asleep among you, Paul said, because they've eaten the communion unworthily. Hallelujah. So I give you this moment. Let's, prepare our hearts to receive. Father, we thank you right now, Lord. God, we come before you, Lord. You said in your word, 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, you are just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. So, Lord, we just come before you right now, Lord, and we're each one of us, Lord. If you need to pause the video, pause it and just confess your sins. Father, we are of all sin, Lord. We've sinned and fallen short of your glory, Lord. Lord, just lead us, Lord. Anything we need to say out to you, Lord, lead us, Lord, in repentance, Lord, by your Spirit, Lord God. Show us, Lord, anything that we have unforgiveness toward anyone. Lord, any ill feelings toward anyone, Lord. Lord, everywhere we've missed the mark, Lord. Anything we need to call out specifically, Lord. Lord, lead us by thy Spirit, Lord. And Lord, we know that we're covered by the blood of Yeshua. Lord, we know your blood cleanses us of all unrighteousness. Lord, we confess our unfaithfulness, Lord. Forgive our sins. Heal our land. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Restore the church that bears your name, that revival may come to each of us once again. Hallelujah, Lord God. Yes, Lord. So let's take, let's eat some of this to the Lord. This is his body. Hallelujah, Father. And just take, if you need to pause the video and worship the Lord and praise him, do it. Because we're doing this in remembrance of the Lord. He is in the midst of us. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord Jesus. You know that the Lord took, then he took the cup of the fruit of the vine. And I use non-alcoholic. And the reason why I do, because the Bible says that if you're a preacher, 1 Timothy, it says you should not be given to wine. And then Jesus said, I will not drink of this until I drink it with you again in heaven. So the Lord Jesus said he would not drink with his disciples until they drank the wine of joy in heaven. So for me, if I'm going to drink wine, it's when the Lord's going to give it to me and say, here, you can drink this with me in heaven. So brothers and sisters, the Lord lifted it up and said, hey, this is my blood that was shed for you. His blood is what makes us whole. Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord, for the blood. I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for the blood. Your blood has made us whole, Lord. Hallelujah. You have washed away our sins in your precious blood, Lord Jesus. We take in remembrance of you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchased of God, filled with His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song. I'm praising my Savior all the day long. Hallelujah! He's worthy. Hallelujah! Blessed be the name of the Lord, brothers and sisters. Bless His name. God bless you all. I will be going down to Florida. I'm going to pass by the Holy Land Experience while I'm down there. I know it's probably a little bit corny, but for my son, I think he would enjoy it. He's going on 6 years old, and I think he can, you know, they got lots of activities there for kids. So I think it's going to be nice. And for my wife, she wants to see, they have a replica of the temple and all that there. So, you know, it'd be nice for them to see it, you know, in real life, because it's hard to picture it, you know, and then they could see it. And so praise God for that, brothers and sisters. I'll be meeting with people Wednesday night there in Orlando. I've already had several people contact me. Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, you contact me, and I'll give you the location, and I'll be meeting people there. They have a conference room there at the hotel where I'll be staying at. I'll be meeting people down there just in Orlando on Universal Boulevard. And after that, brothers and sisters, you know, it's if I hear from enough people in Tampa or in St. Augustine, I'll be going there after that. That's this week, this Wednesday coming up, brothers and sisters. And then also, to say this, in May, I'm going to be going up to D.C. It looks like second week of May or third week of May, I'll be going to Washington, D.C. area over there. And then I don't know about in between, but in August, I'll be going to Dallas, Fort Worth in August. It's going to be nice and hot, right? Be going to Dallas in August, and then I'll be going to Vancouver, and then up in that area. I forgot the name of the place, about an hour east of Vancouver, but there's a big lake there. Going to be baptizing people, and that will be probably the third week of August. I'll be up there all around Vancouver, and I could even, you know, have lots of people in Seattle. I can come back across to Seattle. I may go into Seattle and then drive up to Canada. Not sure exactly how I'll do it yet. Haven't gotten my travel itinerary worked out exactly. But anyway, praise God. And I'm just waiting for the Lord to line things up of where we may go. You know, I don't have any schedule for June or July yet. So just waiting on the Lord, brothers and sisters, how He would have it play out. So I ask you to please contact me, you know, as the Lord leads, because I've been looking at several places and heard from one or two here and there, one or two there. It's up to the Lord. Either tell me or have a whole bunch of people in one area contact me. And, you know, I also take that as an open door if I don't hear anything from the Lord. So anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you all. I hope that you had a great resurrection day. And I don't know if I'll be able to make videos while I'm in Orlando too much this coming week. So I ask for your prayers for safe travels and return, and for the people that I would meet there, you know, that God will have His way. And I need your prayers, brothers and sisters. And of course, I just want to thank all the people that helped us with Joshua's ministry. We're going on 5 years. We just had Joshua's birthday last week. He would have been 10 years old this year. So anyway, brothers and sisters, I thank those who have been helping us with keep the 3 orphanages going, and the 1,000 poor children that we feed and teach about the Bible and do Bible, you know, like a vacation Bible school every weekend. Different groups of children all over the area through churches there in the Philippines. And, you know, without PayPal, it's been a little bit harder. But thank the Lord, people have been supporting through all these different ways. And, you know, we've got lots of things we need to do around the orphanages and vehicles and all this we need to do. So I ask you guys to pray for that we would have an increase in the flow of funds so that we need to paint some of the stuff at the orphanage. We need a new vehicle. We're trying to sell the one we have and get a different one, et cetera, et cetera. And we always have lots of, you know, the children's school uniforms. You have to wear uniforms in the Philippines, even the public school. So it's every year. They need new uniforms. They need this. They need that. School starts at the beginning of June there in the Philippines. So we're coming into that time frame for all those things. We're doing vacation Bible school at the orphanages. And, of course, we always, you know, we invite all the local kids. And we, you know, we give them food. And we have, you know, lots of prizes and all that. So there's special budgets for all those things, brothers and sisters, that we're always needing. It's never enough. You know, the more we have, the more we can do. There's no limit, I don't think, to what we can do. We would have, if we had the funds, we would have 10 orphanages, I guess, as the Lord would lead, 20 orphanages, whatever. It's totally up to the Lord. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you all. May the peace of the Lord be with you. I pray for the Lord to bless you. with his peace, with his joy and his love right now in the name of Jesus Christ. I ask you just to receive your healing, your deliverance, because the Messiah, the word Messiah, go look it up. I need to do a video on it one of these days. The meaning of the word Messiah, it's healer, deliverer, all those things. You know, your salvation, you know, just like when Jesus with a man, I'm going into another message, but the Jesus with the man, he told him to, you know, be of good cheer, your sins are forgiven you. And that's in Matthew, like the time he called Levi, who is Matthew. And he was there, and he said, I think that's Matthew chapter 9, maybe. And he said, be of good cheer, your sins are forgiven you. And then the Pharisees were saying to themselves, you know, who is this guy to forgive sins? Only God can forgive sins. And Jesus said, well, you know, which is easier, to say your sins are forgiven you, or, you know, or to be healed? So he said to the man, just so these people will know that the Son of Man has power to forgive sins, he said, take up your mat and go home. He healed the guy physically. So, and then we see in Genesis, and this, I'll just give a short version of this. In Genesis, the Lord said, God said to Adam and Eve, when you eat the fruit of the tree, you're going to die if you eat the fruit of the tree. So, you know, death has resulted, as the Bible says, since the time of Adam and Eve. So the fruit of sin, or the result of living in a fallen world, the result of sin is death. And most people die. It's not just accidents, but like Adam and Eve and all those people, they died from sickness. They died of something, deterioration of their body. So sin is the physical fruit or manifestation of death. And sickness is the manifestation of the fact we live in a fallen world. Now, Christians die every day. Christians get cancer. Christians get sick. We know that. And the reason why is because we live in a fallen world. But when we're healed, you know, part of salvation, you know, physical healing, that's why the Lord will heal us. Because part of the deliverance from sin, the fruit of that and result of that in the manifestation to say, hey, Jesus has power to forgive our sin, is he heals people. You know, here, and then he, like himself, of course, he overcame death, hell, and the grave. He resurrected from the dead, and it says in that same spirit that resurrected Jesus will resurrect us also. Hallelujah. But in the meantime, the Lord saves us when we call upon his name and repent and call upon his name and believe, you know, that we're sinners and we need to be forgiven and Jesus died for us. And then we can be healed, and all those things is a result of the covenant in the blood of Jesus that we have that overcomes the fallen world. Hallelujah. So when God does a miracle, I'm doing it to a whole nother sermon, but a miracle by definition is overcoming the normal state of things in this fallen world. So when God heals somebody against their sickness that they have, the Lord has intervened in the normal course of events that happens in the fallen world. He raises someone from the dead. There are people who are raised from the dead all the time. As a matter of fact, Assemblies of God tracks people who are raised from the dead. And they, you know, they keep a record of it. They try to get documentation in the whole nine yards. I forgot now. I've said before in a video, you know, how many people are raised from the dead every year through, you know, throughout the Assemblies of God, which is in the whole world, you know, that they have documentation on. I forgot how many people it is. Is it 30 people or 20 people? It's not that many, but there's some. I mean, one is a lot. So anyway, you have that. And then by his stripes, you know, the Lord has made a way for us. That's what the meaning of the word Messiah. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I'll save that one for next time. But anyway, God bless you all. You know that I love you all. And I thank you all for being brothers and sisters to me. And I just thank the Lord for every person that's messaged me and said, hey, you know, give their testimony. You know, how that, well, you know, I watched one of your videos and God used it and then I came back to the Lord or was healed or et cetera. It's a huge blessing to hear back people's testimonies. You know, you gave me a word and then it came true. As a matter of fact, I had a sister that contacted me from Florida the other day and I'd given her a word and I didn't know. I don't think that she had some legal thing going on and she won that. You know, I'd given her a word that she was going to win. And then she did, and she contacted me to let me know that I think she actually won like a year or two ago, but at least she contacted me, even though it was a year or two later, but she was telling me that, you know, the word I gave her had come true, and she just wanted to let me know to encourage me. So I said, praise God. You know, and I hear those things almost every day, all different kinds of stuff. So praise God for that, brothers and sisters. Like I say, I don't usually talk about them, but we should. You know, it's awesome to build up the faith of the church to people give their testimonies. So since this is on the internet, I can give the testimony of what people write me. And if I remember, I'm going to try to do that more often. You know, try to maybe give one each video. Because I hear the people email me every day with one. So praise God. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless. I'm going to get off of here. I got to get up and roll out early tomorrow morning. So I'm going to get this loaded. And God bless you all, and have a blessed, blessed day. God bless.